لله رب العالمين والآقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وكريمنا وشفيعنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصلي عليه. I greet you with the universal greeting of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I welcome you to another episode of the Sunni Path. Inshallah, we will be discussing this book, which is known as Dalilu Zairin bi anna al Muslimin laysu quburiyin. Evidence for the visitor that the Muslims are not grave worshippers. The reason for discussing this book is that there is the corrupt sect who are the Wahhabis, and they accuse Muslims who go and visit the graves of the Anbiya and the Awliya of being mushrikeen, idolaters. And this is not good. So we learn from the Quran and Hadith the permissibility of going and visiting these holy sites, which Allah gave us the permission and Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the permission. Alhamdulillah, in our previous episode, we spoke about where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us permission to go and visit the blessed grave of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Although Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Baz, they say that it is not allowed to go with the intention of visiting the blessed grave of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we proved from the Quran and using syntax and grammar to understand the permissibility of visiting the blessed Rawda of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we also mentioned authentic ahadith. Today we are going to speak about going and visiting the graves of the shuhada, the martyrs. This is also based on the fatwa of Ibn Baz, where he says that it is prohibited to go with the intention of visiting the graves of the shuhada. I would mention to you the hadith of Sayyidina Uqba bin Amir radiallahu anhu. He says, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went to the martyrs of Uhud and he made dua there after 8 years. Like he was bidding farewell to those people who are living and those people who passed away. Then he stood on his minbar and he made this following statement. He said, I shall be your forerunner and I am upon you a witness. Surely your meeting place will be at the fountain of Kawthar. And surely I am actually looking at the fountain of Kawthar from where I am standing. And I was given the keys of the treasures of the entire earth, of this entire dunya. And surely I do not fear that you will make shirk after me, but I fear that you will compete in this world. And this was the last time that he gazed at Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. This is a muttafaq alayh hadith, unquestionable authenticity. It's agreed upon by the two imams. Now what do we learn from this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Number one, he is showing us that he went to visit the graves of the martyrs of Uhud. So it is permissible for us to go and visit, because this is a sunnah fi'li, a practical sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to go and visit the graves of the martyrs of Uhud. So when you get people like Ibn Baz says that it is haram, but it is prohibited and it leads to shirk, you can understand. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he went and he visited. The Prophet ﷺ prayed and he made dua there. So to make dua at the graves of these holy people is not shirk. So when any Wahhabi comes and he claims that it is shirk, then we know Rasulullah ﷺ would never make shirk, and he made dua at this blessed place. Then we take the hadith of Rasul ﷺ and we see that he stood on a minbar. Now we ask the question, is there a minbar, a pulpit, a stage at the graveyard? No. So it means that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went to Uhud, he took a minbar with him because he had an intention to speak to the companions. And when they put his pulpit and his minbar and he stood upon it, he spoke to them. So the Prophet carried the minbar for a specific reason. And then he spoke to the companions in a group. And what did he speak to them about? He spoke to them about the Sharia. He gave them the rulings of the Sharia. And he spoke to them about his status, how high he can see the Akhirah while he's still on the dunya. And when he gave them this advice and he said, I don't fear for you shirk, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done all these actions. Nowadays, you get the Wahhabis, if someone calls up a gathering and he speaks to them about the awliya Allah, if he speaks to them about the shuhada, if he speaks to them and gives them the sharia, what do they claim? This is a bid'ah. But here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done it himself. The next point we take out, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, he gave them this Islamic knowledge and he spoke about three points. The first point, what he says, I am your forerunner. He was giving them the announcement that he is going to pass away. And then at the same time he says, but I am a witness upon you people. Then the second point is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is being a witness upon you and the meeting place will be Kawthar. And the third point we're going to make is that the Prophet ﷺ, from standing on his minbar, he could see the Hawd and the fountain of Kawthar. So what Rasul ﷺ is telling you? That even after his passing away in the first point, I'm going to be your forerunner. I'm going to pass away, but I am still going to be a witness upon you. That means that the Prophet ﷺ, like how he is seeing you in this dunya, we already proved that he would be able to see you when he passes away and see your a'mal, because it is presented to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And whatever he sees good, he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whatever he sees bad, then he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam then says, after I see your good actions, when you come to the Hawd, to the fountain, then you will be able to drink. Our meeting place will be there. So if you've done good deeds and you are a good believer, bearing in mind that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is watching your actions, then you will do good deeds. And then you will meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the Hawd of Kawthar. And you will drink from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where when you drink from the Hawd, from the fountain of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you would never be thirsty after that. And the third point, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that I can see, I am standing on the minbar on this dunya, and I can see in the akhirah. I can see the fountain, my fountain in the akhirah. So why are there people still today who want to reject Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They want to say that no, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he can't see our actions in the dunya. If he can see the actions in the Akhirah, he can see the Hawd and the fountain in the Akhirah, then it's much more easy for him to see your actions in the dunya. He can see right in the Akhirah, but he can't see in the dunya. We already proved with Sahih, proved that he can see in the dunya. It's not only our logic that we are using. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam then makes a very grand and important statement for all of us. Where does he make this statement? At the graves of the martyrs of Uhud, of the shuhada of Uhud. You get Bin Baz, he says that no, to go and visit the martyrs of Uhud leads to shirk. And here Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says at these blessed graves, he says, I don't fear after you, or after me, I don't fear after me that you would commit shirk. So at the graves, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I don't fear for your shirk. Why did he make this grand statement? Because he knew people would be like bin Baz and Ibn Taymiyyah and these Wahhabis who will claim that Muslims who go and visit the graves of the Awliya and the Anbiya, they will be accused of making shirk and becoming grave worshippers. So Rasulullah alayhi wasallam protected us. And then he says further, but I fear for you, you will compete in the dunya. Look at the Saudis today. They are demolishing the graves of the shuhada, the graves of the pious people, the Ahlul Bayt of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why? Because they say they fear for you shirk. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, I don't fear for you shirk. He says, I fear for you the dunya. You will compete in the dunya. And you see what these Wahhabis are doing? They are building tall buildings and they're building hotels and they are competing in the dunya. And then they say they want to come and save our tawheed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from the fake tawheed. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave us this clear example. So when we go and visit the blessed graves of the awliya and the anbiya, we are doing a sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not as the Wahhabis claim, grave worshippers. We ask them, are they more keener to us believers than Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Do they feel that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do his duty? Are they accusing him to say that he is the one who showed us and is leading us to shirk? Do they think that they are better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? These Wahhabis, they are here to destroy the Muslims. They are here to destroy the iman of the believers. Look, Bin Baz, when he gave this fatwa, it's not the only fatwa he gave. There's another fatwa where he speaks against Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu. He says Imam Hussein was on the wrong path. But Yazid, the one who martyred and killed Sayyidina Hussein, he says, no, that person, he was on the rightly guided path. Ya salam. This same Ibn Baz, in his annotation of the Fathul Bari of Ibn Hajar, he writes one statement under the hadith where Bilal, Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu, Bilal bin Harith al-Muzni, he goes to the grave of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, Ya Rasulullah, your ummah has been destroyed. Ask Allah to send rain. Under this hadith, Bin Baz said, this companion of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a mushrik. Do you see how fast they throw the accusation of shirk on the believers? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from such filthy aqeedah. We go to another point. When you want to go and visit the Ahlul Bayt, the graves of the pious, of the awliya and the Ahlul Bayt, what they tell you? This is shirk. Now let's take the evidence. We spoke about the Anbiya already. Then we spoke about the Shuhada. Now we are going to speak of the Ahlul Bayt. And when we look at the Ahlul Bayt, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha radiallahu anha says that every time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to visit me. She says, every time it was my night with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to go out during the night, a portion of the night, and go to Jannatul Baqi. And then he used to make dua for the believers there. Were the Ahlul Bayt buried in Jannatul Baqi? Yes. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to also go and visit the Ahlul Bayt and he used to make dua. There's another hadith, Sayyidah Aisha says that she used to follow him sometime until he reached Jannatul Baqi and she used to see him making dua for them. So the first hadith, we take the point that she says every time it was her chance. Not once or twice, but every time. So it was a daily routine of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had a routine, a sequence, that every time it was her turn, he used to go in one portion of the night to Jannatul Baqi, to make dua for those people, for the Ahlul Bayt and for the believing Muslims in Jannatul Baqi. So when someone say, no, it's not sunnah to go and visit the Ahlul Bayt, we say that Rasulullah every time he used to go and visit the Ahlul Bayt. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَةِ. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you don't ask them for anything except that they have to have love for the Ahlul Bayt of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you know what we take out from this? That we have to love the Ahlul Bayt so much more than we even love our own family members. More than our own family members. So when we go and visit the Ahlul Bayt, it means that we are showing our love and our connection with Ahlul Bayt and the connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says in the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim that I take oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, definitely it is more beloved to me that I should connect with the close people of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than my own close people. With the qaraba and the family members of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than my own family members. This was the aqeedah of the ashab of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see, this is how we understand that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he loved his Ahlul Bayt. And when we love the Ahlul Bayt, then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves us. He says we must love the Ahlul Bayt because of the love that we have for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Bukhari made this point very clear when he says in the hadith, be cautious about Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't disrespect and displease Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it comes to his Ahlul Bayt. So by us visiting the Ahlul Bayt, indeed, we are showing love and connection to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by following the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he went to Jannatul Baqi and he made dua for them. Here's another hadith. We spoke about Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Quran and sunnah to visit. Then we spoke of the shuhada. Now we spoke of the Ahlul Bayt. And finally we are going to speak about the evidence proving the permissibility of visiting these sacred places. Sayyidina Shaddad bin Aus radiallahu anhu, he says that on the night of Mi'raj, Rasulullah said, I performed two raka'ats of salah at each of these places. Which are the three these places? Rasulullah was referring to Yathrib and to Mount Tur and to Bethlehem, the place where Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam was born. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says he performed two raka'at at each of these places, and Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam informed him at the first place that this will be your place of hijrah. At the second place, he said this is the place where Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the third place, he says this is the place where Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam was born. So we learn from this hadith, which Hafiz Al-Haytham, he says it is authentic, and we get Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani who mentions it in Fathul Bari, and it is mentioned by Imam Tabrani and Abu Ya'la and Al-Bazar, all of them who says that this hadith is authentic. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he visited these places which were attached to the pious people. So to go and visit places which are attached to the pious people is indeed a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We have to understand, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he always taught us which is correct. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa visited these places. And what was the wisdom behind visiting the graves in general and visiting the awliya in specific? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa told us, we learnt in the previous hadith, لِتُذَكِّرُكُمُ الْآخِرَةِ, so it can remind you about the akhirah. So when we remember and we understand and we think of the akhirah, look, when we go to the awliya, we are remembering the akhirah. And we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we build tall buildings, we are actually taken away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we start to rely on people other than Allah and on the dunya. So here actually, by going to the graves of the awliya and the anbiya, we realize this strengthens our tawheed, because we know kullu man alayha fan, everything shall perish and every soul shall have a taste of death except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here everybody is going to have a taste of death. You're going to die, so you cannot be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah is baqi, Allah is forever. So by going to these graves, we are learning the tawheed and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by having these big buildings, we are learning to make partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Saudis and the Wahhabis, they twisted it. They twisted it. Why? Because they want to claim they fake Tawheed. They like to twist things. So we understand from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we remember the awliya and the anbiya, we get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us their nearness. It's a place where du'as are accepted, close to the pious people. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, in Surah 7, verse 161, that the Bani Israel, they had to go and make Tawbah. But where? In the holy lands. So when they go in the holy lands and make Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will forgive them. So nearness to the awliya is a means of gaining Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. By visiting these mazarat of the awliya and the anbiya and the believers is not shirk. But indeed it's a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They like to take the apparent and they confuse the people. So if something, they would say no, because the kuffar, they go and they worship the idols, and now the Muslims, they go to the graves of the Anbiya, so it's the same thing. This is a flawed logic. It won't be said that one of these days you would find out that the Wahhabi, he will give a fatwa, he will say something stupid and silly and illogical, like, you know, the Hindus, they go and they worship the idols. They make sajda to the idols. They prostrate to the idols. In the same way, Muslims, they go to the Kaaba and they also make sajda. And the Kaaba is made out of stone. And the idol is also made out of stone. So as a preventive measure from shirk, you mustn't go and make salah there by the haram. It's possible. Because this is how the logic is. It's a very flawed logic. Because it looks same. We have to understand that if it's apparently looking the same, it doesn't mean it's the same. We have La ilaha illallah with us. So Muslims will never worship graves. But they like to twist things. It's like a person is saying that no, he's going to stop sexual relationship between the husband and wife because people are making zina. If people are making zina, you cannot stop the halal. Although the action here is a sexual relationship and here it's also a sexual relationship. But one, they got a marriage certificate. They are married in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on the other side, they're not. So zina and relationship with the wife is not equal. It cannot be equal. And you cannot make the halal haram as a preventive measure here. Like how they are saying, no, to go and visit the graves of the awliya and anbiya, because some people, they worship idols, so now we're doing it as a preventive measure. If Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made something halal and made something jaiz, no one can have the guts to make it haram. We have to get this point very clear. So this is basically what the Wahhabis do. They like to twist things, so they just take something from one place, put it on another place, and they say, okay, that is the ruling. So when someone comes and they ask you, can visiting mazars lead to shirk? Your immediate response must be, that how can it lead to shirk if Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam went and he visited the graves of the shuhada, when he visited the graves of the Ahlul Bayt, when he visited the graves of the pious believers. So visiting the graves can never lead to shirk, number one. Number two, you have to say visiting the graves of the awliya and the anbiya is a sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which he also encouraged. Thus, it can never lead us to shirk. That's your second answer. The third, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he had any fear for our iman, he would never jeopardize our iman. Why? Because Allah says, Harisun alaykum. That Rasulullah, he was most eager about the believers. And he was the one who wanted to guide the believers the most. So he would never misguide us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by visiting the mazars, One strengthens his iman because this is leading him to the tawheed and the oneness of Allah, and to dhakkirukum al-akhirah, it reminds him of the akhirah. So when he looks at this wali, he looks at the grave of this wali, he sees that Allah has given him so much karama, Allah gave him so much honor, Allah has blessed him, and this wali, he lived his life in accordance with the Quran and Sunnah. So then you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I also want to live my life according to the Holy Quran and the Sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instill in our hearts the true love for the awliya, the true love for the Ahlul Bayt, the true love for the Anbiya. And we must not have this fake type of tawheed. We know that we have La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with us. And we will never worship graves. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I don't fear for you after me that you would commit shirk, but I fear that you will compete in the dunya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us connected to the awliya and the anbiya and the saliheen, and keep us away from those people who are competing in the dunya. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.